Hello, everyone. Welcome back to another episode of the GSD Show, and I'm here with Dan Castellini, CEO of I Love Kickboxing. Dan, welcome to the GSD Show.
Good to see you, Mike. Glad to be here.
Yeah, so we've actually gotten to know each other quite a bit over the last 6 months. I don't remember how we first got connected. It might have been Cameron. Was it Cameron?
It was Cameron or Eric Van Horn, I think.
Yeah, like Eric Van Horn. Mm-hmm. And then from there, then you've been to my house. We've had some dinner.
Yeah.
We've met each other out here. We had dinner last night. And we've gotten to talk a lot about the business because I Love Kickboxing has been around a while, but you just took it over in the last, what, year?
That's right. We took it over right in the middle of COVID.
Right in the middle of COVID.
Right in the middle of COVID. So
during COVID or before COVID happened?
Well, we were in the works to take it over before, then COVID happened, and we closed the deal in the middle of COVID. So.
Right, right. So What was it about I Love Kickboxing? What did you like about it? Because you're one of the smarter guys I've met. And I'm around the business side of it. And I'm actually, that's why I wanted to do this episode. I want to really talk a lot about the business stuff with you and the sales and the marketing, the processes. But what was it about I Love Kickboxing? Because you could have opened up businesses and anything.
Right. You know, I think I had an affinity to the fitness business. I've been in multiple different businesses over my 20-year career in franchising, right?
Okay.
When we found the opportunity to get into fitness with ILKB, we started to do our due diligence. And in that process, you call, you know, as many franchisees as you can. You call some of the top performers, you call some of the middle performers, and you call some of the lower performers. No matter who I called, everybody told me the same story. The product is amazing, the members are incredible, and we just love what we do. So in the franchising space or in business space, one of the most important things is how happy are they with the product, and you know, do they like the business model? So I found that we had a good product, and we had people that loved the product. So that was the foundation of what led me to get involved.
Yeah. I know we've had this conversation. I wouldn't get involved in another business unless I knew I could improve it.
Right.
And I'm guessing you probably came in and you saw all these things that are really good. Somebody already made really good, but there's areas you know you can come in and make better. What are some of the things you were excited to improve in I Love Kickboxing?
We all have our strong suits in business, whether it's, you know, whether you're a creator and you're innovative and you see things and you're the first guy in the business, or you're the operator and you're the guy that creates systems and processes. But, you know, very rarely are we good at all those things, right? So when I looked at ILKB, again, we saw the product was created great, but there were some operational issues that needed, you know, some improvements. So systems, processes, consistency across the brand. The brand grew very quickly in its growth. And at that point, it needed some solid infrastructure underneath it that we felt that we could, you know, actually, you know, add to. So
how many locations do you have right now?
We're about 126 locations right now.
Okay, and licenses sold?
Licenses sold are right around 620. So we've got a lot of studios still to open. We've got a lot of open territory still as well. And we've got a lot of growth ahead of us. So.
Wow, that's awesome. Yeah. Okay, so what's first, second, third? Because, you know, whether you're listening in and you're an independent, you're a part of a franchise, you're a franchisor, and we've got a lot of people listening in this industry, what's first, second, third for you coming in here? I know we've got to fix this first, this second, this third.
Anytime you get into a new business, the first thing you're going to do is come in and just do a lot of learning, right?
Yeah.
So you're going to understand kind of what's there, you know, what needs to be adjusted, and then where you're going to create your game plan from there. Now, buying a business in the middle of COVID throws some wrenches into that, right? So where we thought we were going to go for a second and third is adjusting kind of in the real time. But it's pretty simple. Like, our goal now is to basically re-support the franchise base that we have, update the processes, you know, get ready for growth. So we're doing some rebranding now. We'll have a version 2 of the studios coming out shortly. The teams are working tirelessly along with, you know, partners like yourself and others to sort of understand what do we need to do from a training perspective? How do we put the processes in place for the studios that are easy to replicate? All those operational baseline elements that just have to be taken care of every day, right?
Yeah.
The team is being, you know, restaffed in-house. So we've been rebuilding our team with the new culture and, you know, with that outlook on what's going forward. And at that point, then we'll start to resell more territories and grow the brand, you know, externally and beyond.
So, actual studios, the individual studios, it seems like, especially the one that we're in right now, mm-hmm. I got to spend time with the entire team yesterday, and it was a very dynamic group.
Yeah.
I don't know how many of the locations are like this group, but this group is awesome. And what it seemed like was, people love the brand, like you were mentioning, where we can have a stronger focus was more of like sales processes.
Right.
And the numbers are actually, the sales numbers that they're already converting at are better than what I've seen in the industry. They're above average,
good,
which is pretty impressive. However, there's things that could be improved. So with the sales process, one of the things I tell, you know, fitness studios when I meet them, and this goes for any industry, once you open up a gym or a fitness studio, you're no longer a fitness professional, you're now a business person.
That's
you
right.
just happen to serve fitness, right? And that's what you do. So how are you planning on getting all these studios and all the employees within the studios to really embrace the processes of sales, of marketing, retention, all that?
I mean, when we came on board, one of the things we did was we just started multiple communications weekly. Fortunately, it was COVID. Everybody had to get used to that, you know, sort of process, where pre-COVID, everybody wasn't used to having community. So we've got 3 calls a week, operations, sales, and then specific, you know, regional training calls that are taking place for the owners, for the managers, and the employees. And I think, you know, what's important is that they've got to get into the loop of that, right? So we've got the sales team that's working on sales training. You know, a lot of your team works side by side with several of the studios, kind of getting them refocused on what those processes should look like and how they should be handling that. And then, you know, really it's just repetition. No team really grows without doing the same thing over and over.
Right.
It's not that difficult of a business. It's you know, discipline and repetition and processes to follow, right?
Right.
So getting them engaged, getting it out there and communicating it to them, and then letting them run it through the team.
Yeah.
So
we talked about this in the show a bunch of times. You're never going to open up a second location unless you're profitable on the first one and
right.
you don't have to be in there all the time, right? So
yeah.
that means that the operators, we're going to have to make sure that these operators, each one of them, is really focused on those two things. How do we hit a certain revenue point that makes sense and can fund the next project,
right.
but also how can we make sure our team's actually doing it as well? So with business training, what do you think are like one or two things that the operators as a whole could really improve on or could get more training on?
I think it's the overarching idea that you're not a fitness instructor, you're the CEO of your business. You know, as I talk to our team and I talk to the franchisees out there, as a franchisor, that's what I see our goal is. Our goal is to teach, you know, our franchisees how to be the CEO of their business, how not to put themselves on the schedule, but how to build the teams, how to understand the strengths and weaknesses, and how to actually, you know, construct the teams and execute. So, you know, versus starting some sort of business on your own and trying to figure it all out, franchising is an execution game.
Yeah.
It's a game where you come in with a model that says do these things and do them every day and do them well and do them better every other day. And you execute consistently and you get the results and the better results that you need, right? So it's not one where you have to come in and create. It's very much just executing, building your teams, focusing on the key metrics of your business. Like I said, this isn't a difficult business. We have a product, we market it, and we sell it.
Right.
Right? That's right. It. So whatever your product is, whether it's kickboxing, you know, you got to get it in front of enough people to want to raise their hands and say, I'm interested in it. Then you talk to them and you sell it. So really outside of that, what's left to do is to create a structure inside that is people that want to be there, right? A culture that you want to be a part of, a team that wants to follow you and listen to you, and you lead from the front. A lot of times we have, as owners, the ability or desire to just get in and fix everything ourselves. Well, that's the easy way to fix it, but it's much harder to create a team to actually get in there and do it with you, right?
Yeah.
Business isn't a singular sport, that's self-employment.
Yeah.
You know, business is a team sport. And so until you learn to build your team and get them to all do what they're best at, then you'll be successful.
Yeah.
And then you can go on to your second studio.
Yeah, you know, a big challenge I saw in franchises, not necessarily yours, but just in franchises in general, we work with, you know, for 50 of them now, is you get people that are entrepreneurs that take over a location, and they've got this entrepreneurial craving to constantly create and make new things and add new things and do new things, and it starts to really hurt the brand. If you ever saw the movie The Founder, McDonald's, great idea, he loved it, he started, you know, getting franchisees on board, and then they start selling burritos and tacos and barbecue chicken. He's like, guys, this is not what McDonald's is. And so he stopped looking for the entrepreneurs, the people that couldn't stop that craving, right? And he started looking for people that were incredible integrators,
right.
That this is the brand. You know, I think it's good to have entrepreneurs in the franchise spaces, but I think they've just got to channel, where am I going to be an entrepreneur and where am I not? Creating constant things is difficult for you to manage, but where an entrepreneur can exercise that is, okay, recruiting, building my team, getting them inspired, creating solutions to problems that we can, you know, work as far as a culture goes.
Right.
But as far as, you know, I've seen some franchises, one of them will do personal training, the other, not yours, but one will do personal training, the other one won't do personal training. One of them, the front desk does all the sales, the other one, it's a studio manager that does all the sales. And so there's no consistency. They're just doing whatever they feel they want to do in their location, like it's their own company. How do you plan to mitigate that? Because you've got, there's 126, you said?
Right.
126, you're going to have hundreds and hundreds more based on what you got sold. How do you plan on managing all of that when you got that happening?
You know, two things. I think right now that this is the worst time for that. So, you know, when you're in desperation, you're in COVID, that's actually created a bigger issue than we had prior, right? Mm-hmm. Because all of a sudden you're in dire needs, everybody's kind of in this survival mode. So without leadership through a time like this, people got very distracted with a lot of things. I'll try this to, and rightfully so, with survival.
Whatever I've got to do.
Yeah, whatever I got to do to survive, right?
Yeah.
And we came in right in the middle of that. So we came into a lot of what you're talking about right now. So in every franchise model, you know, our belief is that we're going to create the system that's, you know, the lowest common denominator for everybody to execute. And you're right, we want people to execute it. This is the way to go. If you just do this, you're going to have your best chances at success. And if you replicate it day in, day out, this is where you're going to see growth. Mm-hmm. With that said, you know, we also know that some of the best ideas for the future come from franchisees. So it's a delicate balance to understand that, you know, we have to keep, you know, this sort of level playing field, not allow, you know, diversion, because it does distract the brand, it does distract other people, but also allow for feedback from franchisees that are innovating some things. You know, I think you brought up the founder. I think the, I don't know if it was the Happy Meal or one of the meals actually was designed by a franchisee. So, you know, in an incubator, you know, with some of your franchisees that are a bit more entrepreneurial, it's important, I think, for the franchisor to look at that and say, okay, this guy is actually doing that. We'll acknowledge it, and we'll see, and we'll monitor his results. And if it's something that he actually does well, then of course we're gonna roll it out to the other brand. A lot of franchisors just shut it all down, which, you know, you've gotta have the restrictions on that as well. But you also gotta be open to understand that growth is gonna come from within. As we get hundreds and hundreds of franchisees, they're gonna be way smarter at bringing new things that work to the table than we are, because there's just more of them, right?
Yeah.
So it's a balance, and that's...
How do you create that window where if I'm a franchisee, I know it's okay to come tell you that I'm testing this new thing versus hiding it, afraid that you might shut it down?
The truth of the matter is we don't ever learn till after you've done it. So that's just how it happens. It doesn't come up front. I mean, a lot of times we get a lot of ideas that come up front. So, you know, we'll filter those through the teams, and the teams will evaluate them, and we'll choose to try to test things on our own. But typically, if it's something you're going to do and you have an entrepreneurial spirit, you're not going to tell me about it.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
When it comes to training, mm-hmm. How often would you want your operators to go through business training? Daily, weekly, monthly, what's that look like?
I think it's different for the individual. I mean, I think you need to be engaged in some kind of training consistently. So whether it's business with the franchisor one-on-one, or whether it's you personally engaging in other sort of growth. I know you belong to several masterminds, so yeah. Do I. Today's a different space, and it's one you have to be careful of too, because there's so much different training out there. If you're talking about us as a franchisor, I think that, you know, at minimum, as an owner, you need to be engaged with something that we're doing as a franchisor on a monthly basis. Your teams need to be involved in something in studio almost on a daily basis, whether it's training or interaction. The more you train, you know, the more that you're actually going to succeed, right? Practice makes perfect. You know, any sports teams, any of that, they don't practice once a month. They practice every day, right?
Yeah.
So depending on what it is, but, you know, you really should be engaged in something on a very regular basis. So.
Yeah, you know, one of the things, I was saying practice makes perfect for a long time, then I heard this guy, Keith Cunningham, you ever heard of him?
Yeah.
He said this one phrase that stuck with me. He goes, practice makes permanent. And so if you're practicing the perfect thing, then practice will make perfect. But if you're practicing the wrong thing, you're going to get real good at doing the wrong thing.
Very true.
So if you practice answering the phone the wrong way, if you practice handling a cancellation the wrong way, or responding to a negative review the wrong way, you're going to automatically, without even thinking, get real good at doing it the wrong way. And so one of the things I like about you is you're really focused on the training and making sure that people are getting the right training, so that whatever they are practicing, it is the right stuff.
That's right.
I know you're a big reader, especially if you knew Keith Cunningham, so you're a big reader. So what's a book or two that you're like, I wish every business owner read this one?
You know, I'm a traditionalist, so I've read a lot of books in the beginning of sort of my time in business, right? And then I've switched to, you know, self-improvement type books, and then now there's podcasts and everything out there.
Yep.
You know, I think if you're talking about business in general, and you want to have, you know, a fitness studio or anything really, or multiples of them, like the most pivotal book for me was the E-Myth, because it's you know, and we've all read it, right? It's just a simple book, but it also just outlines the importance, and you can tell it from the way that we're talking today, of what I believe is that you really need to be the CEO of your business. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean you need an ego. It doesn't mean you need to have all this, you know, sort of front-facing fluff, but it means you need to understand the structure of your business and how you want to design your team to get the results that you want to get and sort of what your end goal is. Because if you design it wrong, likelihood is you're going to fail.
It's interesting. That was the first book I've ever read in business. Yeah. And I feel like a lot of people say that. I feel like that book is important because it not only teaches you very important things, but it was an easy read.
Yep.
And it makes it easy for you to go, I should read another one.
Because
if you start with a real heavy book, like a scaling up or something like that,
right.
So much.
It is.
It's such a hard thing to grasp. But E-Myth, if anybody hasn't read that book, don't get the audiobook either. Like, actually get the book, because you're going to want to take notes.
Right.
You're going to want to underline stuff. That's going to be your Bible. I read it probably 4 or 5 times in the very beginning. And he's written a few other things, but that's his golden
staple.
One.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, very cool. And you say you listen to podcasts. What are the podcasts you listen to?
I'm on a hiatus right now because I went through this process of so much information in, and that's the challenge with where we're at today. You know, making sure you plug in to somebody who it's, you know, I was thinking before the interview this morning, there's a lot of stuff out there that 10 years ago you can listen to, and it was traditionally written by one or two people that had theory or people who had proven what they were done and were telling their story. Today, there's just so much information, and there's no really way to tell, you know, whether the data is valid or where it's come from or who's sort of written it. So I don't think it matters who or what you listen to, but I think it's important today is that you don't overload yourself with too much data, because then you won't take action.
Yeah.
Right? You'll be confused by what's out there. So so I align today with anybody who has results that either one that I appreciate or two are where I want to go. So if they're doing a podcast just based on ideas or thoughts, then I don't really spend much time listening to it. If they've had success themselves in whatever it is that I'm looking for, then that's kind of where I set up. So like yourself, right? Like you have a niche, which is in the fitness space. You have a proven success track record. So if people want to understand how to actually market or sell or produce leads or generate, you know, success in operations in the fitness space, they should be plugged into your podcast, right? That's where you want to be, regardless of what you're listening
to. He said that. It's true. And he's not a liar. I've known Dan for a while now.
Yeah.
He means it. But no, I will say this.
It's not a plug. It's just, you know, honestly.
Well, it's here now, me not being biased, it is true. This is the best podcast in the industry. I've learned a lot from a lot of the people that have come on the podcast. And that even goes for some of the employees that have come on. And I'm just like, man, that's really cool. I didn't even know certain things work so well until I really take the time to sit down and interview an employee, and they're on this stage and they're like, yeah, and then if you do this, if you do that, I'm like, man, it's amazing.
Yeah.
So this podcast, I've recommended this to so many studios that I've just randomly gone to and visited. I did it yesterday when I was here. And I think this should be a daily practice for anyone that's running or in the space of fitness. So I appreciate that. Dan, you've got a lot that you've got to work on here, but that's a good thing. But that's everyone. I don't care if you're Orange Theory or anybody, period. You got a lot you got to work on because the industry is so new. That's the challenge right now, is you're not opening up a restaurant where frameworks for the most part established. Mm-hmm. You're in the fitness studio space, and generally this industry is like 10 years old, give or take, right? I think Orange Theory was what, 2009, and then you had some other ones that were smaller. And but really, the way we know it today, where we look out the window and there seems to be one in every shopping center, that's like 5 or 6 years old. So one of the things I talk about with, you know, my team is the industry doesn't have a framework yet as far as, okay, should the front desk do the selling? Should the studio manager do the selling? Should the instructors do the selling? What is it? Like, we always know at a restaurant, the host does the seating, the waiter does the waiting, the cooks do the cooking, the busboy does the busing. That's just how it works. And they all work together to help out, but that's generally the roles. So with what we have going on right now, do you see a difference over the next couple of years, a framework to the I Love Kickboxing brand, whether it's how the front desk works, how the instructors work, studio managers, do you see there being changes to frameworks?
Yeah, I think everything's evolving so quickly right now. So yes, there's definitely gonna be changes. I think there's gonna be a lot of changes. I think the fundamentals will remain the same. I think we look at today and we go, there's technology to do this, there's all these different things that we can use to help us do what we typically do, but the framework really doesn't change, Mike.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, leads go into a system and they're nurtured via text message, or do we call them? You know, either way, you got to work a lead.
Yeah.
You know, what works the best, you just measure and then you share that, and that's what you replicate, right? So I think there's going to be a lot of changes in the next few years, but I don't think the overall framework will shift that much.
Awesome.
So, yeah.
Dan, I appreciate all the time. So whenever I meet with a franchisor like yourself, one of the things I really want to do is start doing like round twos, round threes. Yep. I'm actually excited to do a round two with you in about 6 months to a year.
Be great.
And seeing how the progress has gone, especially knowing I'm going to be able to work with you. I'm going to be able to ask really great questions along the way. So I'm excited for you. I'm excited for the brand. Yesterday was an awesome day for me to be able to be here with this team. I'm here for another couple days, so I'm excited for it. So thanks so much for spending time with me.
Yeah, glad to see you out here.
Appreciate
thank
you. It. For everybody watching, for everybody listening, thank you so much for tuning in, and we'll see you next week.